gravitational redshift. I told you that to spend some time in understanding the derivation that we make in Schwarzschild, because the logic will be the same for all the possible other metrics. And so let me remind you the formula that we got. So the setup is that we consider the Schwarzschild geometry, and we are discussing two observers which are at rest in the usual Schwarzschild coordinates. So they only move in time, so they are at fixed radial distance from in the geometry, and they exchange photons. Okay, so and we are discussing the ratio between the emitted and the detected frequency as a function of the two radii. So the formula that we got last time is this. And I was also commenting that in the regime in which both the two observers, both observers are far away from the Schwarzschild radius, then you can expand this, and what you get is basically the difference between the Newtonian potential at one point compared to the other. Now, let me say a few words about the experiments. So this is a test of general relativity that was for the first time understood by, checked experimentally by Pound and Repka. This is the last, there are three classical tests of general relativity. One is the precession of the orbit of Mercury, or in general the fact that orbits are not are modified in general relativity, and this is what we're going to discuss after this. Then there is the deflection of light, and these two were both discussed originally by Einstein in those years. Later on, people discussed this possible effect, so the change in the frequency of light as it moves in a gravitational potential. And this was verified much later than the other two, in 1960. So it's a sort of last of the three that was experimentally verified. So let me just to give a feeling how people verify this. So first of all, what is surprising to me is that they verified not using you would expect from this formula that you want to have a very large separation between the emitter and the observer. Actually, but of course then you lose control of your apparatus. So the original setup in the 60s was the experiment was done with a separation of around 22 meters. So this is something that you can still see, because it took place in Harvard Physics Department. So if maybe it's now the theoretical physics department. So and basically they did this experiment between the ground floor, the basement, and some small tower. So it's like four floors. So if you go there, well, the experiment is not there anymore, but they can tell you where it took place. But anyway, it was inside the building between the basement and the top floor. And so it's a very ingenious apparatus, because so the idea was the following, that there is some source of photons. In particular case, it was some isotope of iron. And so the basic idea is the following. So I send these photons, and as they go up, they lose a bit of energy, so they change a bit frequency. So hopefully I can So if the effect is big enough, the photon will move enough not to be able to excite iron in the detector. But now, because of course this is not this is what a theorist would do, but an experimenter is a bit clever, more clever, because okay, you don't see, if even if you don't see a signal, what it's very difficult to be able to conclude that this is the effect. So what they were doing is to move this. So basically, they had something that make this detector oscillate, so that on top of this effect. On top of the effect that we calculated, we also have the Doppler effect, okay? That, as we were discussing yesterday, of course, locally, I can talk about Doppler effect, so I can say that compared to a detector at rest, then if I take a detector which is moving, there is a difference in frequency. Of course, let me mention that if you go through the procedure that I was discussing last time, you include the velocity of the detector, of course, the four velocity will change, but at the end, the result include all the effects in the problem. Or alternatively, you can just add to this result the Doppler of the motion of the detector. Okay, so the idea was to make this oscillate, okay, so that there is a particular moment. So photons are absorbed, but only in the regime in which there is a velocity towards the emitter, in such a way that the Doppler effect compensates the loss of frequency due to the gravitational redshift. Okay, so it's not that you see absorption, but you see absorption only when the cycle is correct, in such a way that you compensate the gravitational redshift. Okay, of course it is not enough because okay, if you try to do it, of course. If you take a molecule in a gas, first of all, the molecules have some thermal motion, so that the emission of the photon, so the effect is very small, as you can imagine. So it has to do with well, we're talking about 20. The difference is 22 meters, so it's quite a small effect. So it's a difference in Newtonian potential between just changing by 20 meters compared to the radius of the Earth, which is like 1,000 kilometers. Okay. So it, of course, you want to make the emission very the line to be very very thin. And this would be ruined if you have thermal motion, because of course there is also a Doppler now of emission. Okay. The trick is to use basically. Another problem is that there is also the point of absorption. So if you want the photon to be absorbed by a molecule, there is some small recoil. Okay. So and you have to take all these effects are bigger than what we are trying to measure. So the idea was to use what is called the Mossbauer spectroscopy. Of course, I'm not an expert on this, but the simple idea is that there are regimes in which there is a lattice of atoms, and they behave as a single emitter. Okay, so that, for example, first of all, there is no thermal motion. In a sense that everything is rigid, in some sense. So, for example, when you emit a photon, the recoil is taken by the whole lattice, not by the single particle, and the same happens here. So this makes the lines extremely sharp, and using this trick of making this oscillate, they were able, of course, then they did all the possible checks, so you do the same experiment, they do it upside down, in such a way that you should see the opposite effect, and so on and so forth. Anyway, they were able to measure this effect with a precision of 10%, which was another confirmation of general relativity. Yes, nowadays they do it, for example, using satellites, and I think the precision is like between 10⁻³ and 10⁻⁴, so it's much more precise. Okay, this was just to give a flavor of the experiment. Any question? So let's now talk about, on the other hand, even more basic prediction of generativity, which is the precession of orbits. So, first of all, what does it mean, precession of orbits? It means just simply that, that in, of course, both in GR and in Newtonian gravity, as I discussed, by conservation of the direction of the angular momentum, the orbit of a planet around the Sun is always on a plane. Okay, so it's not in both cases. So by precession, it means the following. It means that in Newtonian gravity, we know that orbits are always closed, in a sense that they are ellipses. Okay? And this is particular in a sense that if you take a generic central potential, this will not happen. So in general, the fact that you have closed orbits means basically that the period of revolution, so the angular period, coincide exactly with the period of oscillation in the radius. Okay, so if you remember when I was discussing this is the radial motion. Okay, so in this picture, basically, if you take a generic bound orbit, you have at the same time a motion in the radial direction, which means that sometimes the planet is farther away from the Sun and sometimes it's closer, while at the same time the planet is rotating around the Sun. So in general, if you take a generic potential, these two periods are not the same. So what happens is that the orbit does not close, but does something like this, and then something like this. I don't know how to draw it, but okay. So what happens is that if you take an ellipse and imagine that you detune a bit Newtonian gravity, instead of being an ellipse which keeps the same orientation, let's imagine that now I touch a bit in such a way that I change slightly the period of one of the two motions. So what happens is that this ellipse start rotating, okay? Because there is no synchronization between the going far away and coming back and rotating. This is exactly what will happen in general relativity. Okay? So in general relativity, as we're going to discuss, the two periods are not exactly the same. Of course, it's a tiny effect. Okay? So it being a tiny effect, it makes sense to describe it as a small, as a slow rotation of the major axis of the ellipse. On the other hand, if you go in a regime in which it is a very big effect, like I was discussing last time, so there are orbits in generativity that have nothing to do with the Newtonian counterpart. So for example, cases in which you rotate many times and then you go away. So these, there are cases, but of course you need to be close to the Schwarzschild radius, in which the Newtonian intuition does not work at all. On the other hand, we are interested in cases in which you are very close to the Newtonian result. So the small detuning between the radial motion and the angular motion makes the Newtonian ellipse rotate slowly on the plane. Okay, so let me be quantitative. So I will do a simplification, which is the following. Of course, one can treat very elliptical orbits, so I mean a generic elliptical orbits. On the other hand, to show the result, I can even concentrate on orbits which are slightly elliptical. Okay. So what does it mean? Being slightly elliptical means that I'm talking about the Newtonian case. I'm very close to the minimum. So if I am at the minimum, it means that I have a fixed radius and I am in a circular orbit. On the other hand, if I now want an orbit which is slightly elliptical, it will describe small oscillations around the minimum. Okay. The advantage is that the treatment is much simpler. So if you remember, already in Newtonian gravity, treating elliptical orbit is slightly complicated in doing the calculations. So I'm going to basically to concentrate on orbits which are slightly elliptical. only slightly, and show that in general relativity these orbits will not remain closed and there will be a precession. Of course, this result is also true for more elliptical orbits, but to show that, first of all, it's a good approximation because the orbits of most planets are close to circular, and also, I mean, the purpose is just to show that this feature of GR, sorry, this feature that holds in Newtonian gravity, the fact that bound orbits closed, does not work in GR. Okay, so the idea again is very simple. So I will take the effective potential that we calculated last time for general relativity, and I will just calculate the two periods of oscillations. So one is this oscillation, which means the radial motion which controls the distance from the sun, and compare this to the period of revolution around the sun. As you do the calculation, notice one thing, because it comes into to your question. So be careful always in these kind of problems to remember what is the time that we're using. In a sense, of course, at the very least, there are two times in the business. There is the coordinate time and the proper time. Okay, so be careful. Okay, this will be very specific, but many times you have to move from one time to the other because one quantity you calculate using some relation, and there is, so be careful about the possible. What I want to stress is that when I say these words about the same period, of course, in Newtonian gravity there is no ambiguity. While in GR, be careful that somebody you need to be discussing about periods calculated with the same time, not with a different coordinate or proper time. Okay, so let me draw the same object for what we discussed last time. So this is in general relativity as a function of the radius. This is the effective potential as a function of the radius. This is a bit extreme. Okay, so this is a thing. So we are going to, I remind you, so we are going to discuss something which is far from the Schwarzschild radius. So the Schwarzschild radius is this point. Okay, but we are in a regime in which basically it looks a lot like the Newtonian intuition. And again, the minimum of this is the circular orbit radius, the stable one. The unstable one is here, but we don't care about that. Now let me draw, let me write what the potential is. I mean, it's what we calculated last time. So there is an irrelevant constant, then there is the Newtonian potential, then there is the centrifugal barrier, and then there is the correction which makes it different from Newtonian gravity, which is this correction, which leads to this drop, a small relief. So, well, it's quite straightforward. So I have to calculate the minimum of this potential, and then to calculate the period of oscillation, or small oscillations around this minimum. Okay. So first of all, I look for the minimum, which is v prime equal to zero. This is something that we did already last time. So this gives an equation of this sort. Nothing deep. So I solve, in a sense, I want to look for this RC, which is the minimum. So you can solve this equation, and in particular, you can find the angular momentum as a function of the radius of the circular orbit. Okay, I just solve this. And then I look I calculate basically the second derivative of this effective potential, call it GR, with respect to the radius, twice. So this is the second derivative of this function. It gives me the small oscillations around the minimum. I evaluate this at the circular radius. And let me stress this point, Now, okay, this will describe some omega squared of small oscillations. We rest to which time? Okay, if you go back to what we said last time, you remember I was using all the Concert quantities, and the bottom line was that I have a system which looks a lot like a one-dimensional mechanical system. The kinetic energy is dr in d tau squared times 1/2. So I stress this to say that in the mechanical analogy, the time of this evolution is the proper time of the planet moving around the sun. Okay? So be careful, because sometimes if you come from other direction, this is not the case. Okay, so what I'm stressing is that this will give me some frequency, which I call radial frequency, of oscillations around the minimum. Okay, so again, this tells you the frequency at which the planet go far away from the sun and come back to the sun. Okay, with respect to the proper time of, which is not, it's not, this not, that's why one of the corrections. So if this is related to the proper time. So if I ask you what is the oscillation frequency related to the coordinate time, then you have corrections which involve other powers of the Newtonian potential. Okay, so let's do the calculation. Well, it's straightforward. So I do another derivative out of this, and I evaluate everything at the circular radius. Okay, so this is nothing more than the second derivative evaluated at RC. Now, since I want to evaluate at this point, I use this relation, which I derived requiring that this is a minimum. So I substitute L squared with this expression, and what I get is Gm over RC cube times this expression. Okay, so you may remember that this is the Newtonian result. Well, it must be the Newtonian result, because of course when my circular orbit is very far from the Schwarzschild radius, that is to say RC is much bigger than 2gm, okay, then this becomes 1, because I can forget about this. So this is the Newtonian result. Now, what we're going to do, now, we want to compare this frequency with the frequency of revolution around the sun, and see that they are different. So let me erase this. So again, the frequency of revolution, of course, is related to the angular momentum. So if you remember the definition, so last time we said that L, the same L that appears here, if you remember how we derive this, so we are using the quantity which is conserved because of rotational invariance, and we are plugging it back for the radial motion. So this L is nothing more than R squared d phi over d tau. Again, it's related to the proper time, not with the coordinate time. Okay, so I remind you, this is the velocity in the phi direction. What is conserved is that times the metric. So this is the metric in the phi direction, assuming that we are moving on the plane theta equal to pi over 2. Okay, this is what we did last time. I want to express the velocity in the radial direction, and the L can be, you can use this because I want to evaluate at the circular point. So omega phi squared, so the corresponding of this but now in the phi direction, is L squared over r to the fourth. Okay, so I'm looking at the square of this to compare with this. This RC. So this object, using that formula, is Gm over RC cube Let me write this. Okay. So what I need, I just need this. I write it as a function of L. L is given by this in the minimum, and I express it in this way. So you see that when I can neglect the sparse radius, I go back that this is equal to this. So what we are checking is that in Newtonian gravity, in the limit of orbits which are close to circular, so this does not prove that. So what is remarkable is that in Newtonian gravity, all closed orbits, all bound orbits are closed. Here we are discussing about the small oscillations, so orbits which are close to circular. But anyway, in this limit, in the Newtonian case, I can neglect the Schwarzschild radius and the two frequencies are the same. But you see that the subleading corrections are not the same. Okay. So you see that, and you also see that, again, there is this expansion, which in general does not truncate. Okay. So it's true that you only have this, but then when you start solving, you have an infinite amount of corrections. Since we are looking at planets, this correction will be small, so it makes sense to expand at first order. So I erase this, but remember what's happening. Also, you see, the orbits does not exactly close because this, you see that this is larger than this. Okay? So, if you want, it comes back at the same angle faster than the radial motion. Okay, so it's like it precedes in the direction of rotation. So let's we can calculate the precession frequency, which is can use this. The precession frequency is the difference between the two frequencies. So omega precession, by definition, is the difference between the radial, the angular frequency minus the radial frequency. And this is equal to, expand this, is the common value for the two frequencies in Newtonian gravity times the 3gm over RC. Okay? So you get 3gm over 3 and another one from there under the square root, you're left only one. So this is a small correction. This is one obvious question. So you might know that people were looking at Mercury as a possible test of this effect. So why Mercury and not another planet?
It's closer.
Because it's closer, no? So as I was stressing last time, at the end, the correction from general relativity are always the ratio between the radius at which you are doing the experiment compared to the Schwarzschild radius. Okay, the Schwarzschild radius we calculated is 3 kilometers. So if you want a big effect, you have to take a planet which is close to the Sun, okay, so that this ratio is as big as you can. Well, the radius of Mercury, it's of order 6 × 10⁷ kilometers. So compared to 3 kilometers, so this is something which is smaller than 10⁻¹. Okay, so it's a 10⁻¹ effect. So this means that you will have a complete rotation of an axis only after 10⁷ years. Small effect. No, I don't know too much the story, so I'm just repeating what people say. So it's a bit tricky because it's not completely an obvious thing, because there are other effects which perturb the orbit of Mercury, for example the presence of Jupiter, and also other possible things, like the fact that the Sun is not exactly spherical. So there are small effects. So these so nowadays everything is very settled, but as far as I understand, disentangling these Newtonian perturbations from the pure GR effect was a subtle thing. So if I remember well, this effect is smaller than the effect of Jupiter, so you have to be careful. It's not much smaller, but it is smaller. So okay, this is to say that it's not very completely obvious that if you see some precession is due to general relativity, so people have to take into account all the effects, but nowadays we are happy. I mean, nowadays, sorry, I just described these things historically. Nowadays, as I will describe, we also study objects for this. These are not corrections, these are order one effects. So nowadays we can probe systems very close to the Schwarzschild radius, like two neutron stars orbiting at a distance which is like 10 times the Schwarzschild radius. So you see that, so it's like doing, so in this Schwarzschild radius, we have situations in which this RC is not much bigger than the Schwarzschild radius, so that the Newtonian approximation of this function does not really make sense. So now, of course, we are now quite confident about GR. Okay, any question? Okay. So, if there are no questions, we go on studying this geometry. So far, everything has been quite easy and perturbative. So basically, everything is similar to Newtonian gravity up to small corrections that you can calculate, okay? So the next step is to try to understand this geometry also when you go closer to the Schwarzschild radius. Yes.
We consider when we make our analysis from the beginning that we maybe have a non-rotating object, just the point like object, let's say, spherical object, which is moving our potential. But we know that.
Sorry, you're talking when you say non-rotating, you're talking about the Sun or the planet?
The planet.
So wait a second. For the planet. We are using the geodesic equation. Mm-hmm. So, okay, go ahead, maybe I answer when I know the question.
Yeah, so when we use the geodesic equation, we don't consider the planet itself rotation about itself, about its axis, and, mm-hmm. right? And this is a... is this relevant to this...
No, it's not. So let me. But it's a good question. So you may ask yourself. So you use the geodesic equation to describe the motion of an object. Now you can ask what are the approximations that we are using when we use the geodesic equation. Okay. So so the way you should think about the geodesic equation is the following. In some sense, the geodesic equation is not some equation that you have to accept, so it's not part of general relativity. In the following sense, so I write the equation in this way, where V is the, let me call P, the momentum of the particle. No? So what is the origin of this geodesic equation? Well, one way of looking into it is just saying, okay, I know since the motion of an object is local, okay, in saying this, I'm already doing an approximation that I will come back to. So in some sense, I'm saying I take an object which is much smaller than the radius of curvature of my geometry. Okay, so I'm taking an object which is point-like, but what does it mean? It means that it's much smaller than the variation of the gravitational field. Okay? So once I can do that, then I can say, okay, then they told me that I can always choose coordinates such that locally the system goes back to Minkowski and the Christoffel symbols are zero. Okay. So so you see, this equation, once you go to this coordinate system, it just becomes trivial, it becomes basically this. So this is nothing more than basically the derivative, the total derivative with respect to proper time, because this is dx mu in d tau. So this just tells you that p alpha is constant. Okay. So let me, like, I don't know how you derive it, but I want to describe it in this way, so it's a bit arcane. So my way of seeing this equation is the following. Maybe I never learned how to study the motion of particles in generative. But I know the equivalent principle. So I know that in the approximation that I was describing, I have a point particle. Locally, I don't know anything, but I know that I can choose coordinates in such a way that locally I am in Minkowski. In Minkowski, if there are no forces, the momentum is conserved. So I don't need anything. So I know special relativity. I know that the momentum is conserved. So I write this equation, which tells me that the momentum is conserved. Then this step is just that instead of at each point of the trajectory going to the coordinates which are locally Minkowskian, better to write the same equation in a way which is coordinate invariant, so that I don't need every time to go to this local coordinates. Okay, so this is in this derivation you understand what are the assumptions. So the assumptions is that the object is much smaller than the typical thing. In the same way to answer your question, you can start having a deviation from this equation only when, and this can happen, when the object itself starts having tidal forces, meaning that the size is such that it starts feeling the fact that the curvature of space cannot be neglected locally. Okay. But this is not the case, and it's nothing to do with rotation. In a sense, if it is small and rotating, but it's much smaller than the typical variation of the gravitational field, then the geodesic equation will follow. No? So it's nothing to do with the effect of rotation, unless by rotation you say I'm talking about an extended object, so that these corrections are not negligible. Okay.
Yeah, but when massive objects rotate, does it emit the gravitational waves or?
Well, now you're making it. It's a separate question, no? Okay, let me separate the question even more. So, of course, if an object rotating, this has nothing to do with rotation. So, of course, when I look at an object which is moving in the geometry, in the sparse geometry, this object will emit gravitational waves. Mm-hmm. But this has nothing to do with the spin of the object. It has to do with the fact that in general there is a non zero quadrupole. Okay, and let me point this. Yes. Let me mention this since you're asking. So this is a nice thing. As you might imagine, to calculate. People spend a lot of time in calculate emission of gravitational waves because experimentally this is very interesting and important. What we are doing now does not apply if I have two black holes with the same mass, because what we are doing here is to treat a point particle moving in the sparse geometry. So this applies if you're talking about a small object, like a small black hole, a small neutron star, moving around a bigger one. Okay? So in this regime, which is useful, when there is a separation of masses between one object and the other, one can treat the system in this way, and then So calculate the orbit and then calculate the emission of gravitational waves just looking at the quadrupole that this object has. Okay, so this is a limit in which people do calculations. So in this case, you emit gravitational waves. But it's nothing to do with, well, now spin will be a correction to this, but you emit gravitational waves even without rotation of the things, it's just because you are moving. Any other question? Yeah.
When we have non-point light particles, is the Schwarzschild method still like a good method to use? Because I mean, my question is if we still can consider if it is time independent and spherically symmetric?
Sorry, your question has to do with the presence of this additional field.
For example, as Mahmoud asked, if we have a big object, mm-hmm. Or rotating around another one, then we still preserve the spherical symmetry.
No. Of course, you don't. In fact, what I say is the following: if you want to study what the two black holes do as they are orbiting each other, this is very complicated. Does not follow this, and indeed they cannot basically only be solved numerically. But what I was saying is a particular limit in which one of the objects is so small that I can treat it as a tiny perturbation compared to the Schwarzschild geometry. So you're absolutely right. So of course the presence of this object breaks the symmetries, but if I have a big object and the Schwarzschild geometry, then I put this test particle moving around, okay? This is a limit in which not only I can calculate the orbit, but then I can also calculate the emission of gravitational waves. And this is very interesting because it's not only a limit in which you can do the calculation, but it's also a case of astrophysical interest. So we didn't detect them yet, but it's a case of astrophysical interest, these cases in which there is a hierarchy between the one black hole and the small one. So in this case, but only in the case there is a hierarchy between the two masses. Any other question? Okay, if not, let's try to go closer to the Schwarzschild radius. So let's do step by step. So we want to go closer to the Schwarzschild radius, which for reason that will become clear later, we can also call it the horizon. So the first thing is, so if you never saw this, be prepared that the thing is somewhat counterintuitive. I'm saying this because, okay, now everything tells you that everything is straightforward. So, just to tell you how complicated things can be, the metric, the form of the metric that describes this geometry, that make everything transparent, was only obtained in the 60s. Okay? So, this just to say that for many years it was not completely straightforward and obvious what was going on. So, I mean, just to say that, don't. If it's the first time if you see it, don't be scared that it's a bit counterintuitive. So let's start focusing. First of all, let's forget the angular coordinates. Let's focus on r and t. Okay? And let's look at. So let me first of all write the metric focusing on these. And look at the light cone as I approach the Schwarzschild radius. Okay, so I forget about the angular variables. So the first thing that one can ask is the following. So what light rays do in this geometry? Okay. And that because the conclusion that we're going to get is something that it's not true in the end. But, the equation that I write are correct, hopefully, but the intuitive meaning is not so transparent. So I set the dS squared equal to zero. So this will tell me, I'm talking about photons which only move in the radial direction, okay? And I want to, I can draw a diagram describing the light cones. So I calculate what is dt in dr. Okay, so this is, well, you said this is equal to zero, so this is plus or minus 1 minus 2 gr over r to the minus 1. Okay, I just do this. Now let me plot these things. Okay. So if I leave, so I plot it in the plane tr, and imagine that I live very far from the black hole. So very far from the black hole, this correction is small, okay, so this is 1, and I get the usual result that the light cone is at 45 degrees. Okay, so this is the... Okay. So in particular, I draw the future light cone, and it is the same as in Minkowski, okay? Now, the surprising thing is that as I go closer to the spatial radius, this object goes to 1, so this goes to infinity. So this means that as I go closer and closer to the spatial radius, 2gm, light cones close. So you see what's happening, that in this geometry, at least in these coordinates, what happens is that you cannot cross the horizon. Why? Because if you are an observer, your world line is time-like. So you can always move, I mean, basically what I'm saying is that you can only move inside the light cone. And when I say this, has nothing to do with geodesics. So whatever is your state of motion, if you have rockets or whatever, of course, locally you have to remain inside the light cone. Okay? But if you want to remain outside, inside the light cone, it means that you see that you cannot cross the horizon, because you can all, as you go closer and closer, you can only move in the time direction. Okay? So you cannot cross the radius r equal to 2gm. Okay, so if I, in other words, imagine that I draw some curve. Okay, since it is must be time-like everywhere, the only thing that I can draw, if I try to go towards the horizon, I draw something which is like this. Because if I draw some, so imagine that on the other end I draw something that crosses the horizon. Well, at this point, this curve is space-like, so it cannot be a curve describing an observer. Okay. So the first surprising result is that in this geometry, contrary to maybe, so you, I was saying that you are going to fall in the black hole looking at this. I was saying that there is a modification of the effective potential which makes possible for orbiting particle to fall in the black hole. On the other hand, at least in these coordinates, the message is that you cannot cross the spatial radius. Now, let me, before going on this apparent paradox, let me comment on an example which will become, hopefully, to explain something about this situation. Okay. Well, maybe I can already anticipate the answer, because I don't want to create a suspense. But, so, the issue would be the following. So, the claim is correct. It is true that in these coordinates, all the curves do not cross the spatial radius. On the other hand, the physically correct question is not as a function of the coordinate time, but as a function of the proper time. So the correct question would be, should be, does a curve cross the spatial radius in a finite proper time? The answer to this question is yes. Okay. So that, putting these things together, what happens is that this curve goes to time equal to plus infinity, but it does it in a finite proper time. Okay. So that, so it's not, then you have to continue. Okay. But, okay, this was,
So an observer in infinity will not see the of the guy that it's
exactly it won't. It won't. It's a good question. It's a good point because because I don't be careful. I'm not saying that what you are reading in these coordinates has no meaning, so you should just not use these coordinates. As he's saying, this contains a message because if I live here, okay, and imagine imagine that this observer falling in the black hole for every second of his watch sends a signal back to infinity. Okay, so every second send a signal. So you see, this process will go on forever. Okay, in a sense, maybe it will become more clear when I do a couple of calculations. Let's put two things together. So I'm telling you that the proper time to go from one point to the horizon is finite. So this means that the number, there will be a finite number of pulses that I send back before crossing the horizon. On the other hand, in these coordinates, all these pulses will be distributed in infinite amount of time. So this means that from an observer living with a world line like this, this guy will go on receiving forever new pulses, okay? All these pulses will be outside the horizon. So if you want, the guy can tell, I will send you pulses until I cross the horizon. Well, the guy will go on receiving signals forever because the geodesy is like this, no? So it goes on forever. Okay. So the two things are compatible because, as we're also going to explain, the redshift as you approach you already saw it before the formula that I raised. There is an infinite redshift as I go closer and closer to the Hubble radius, which is compatible with the fact that you send a finite number of signal in an infinite time. Okay? So this corresponds to an infinite amount of redshift. Yes.
You say that for the falling observer, in a finite proper time, you will reach the horizon. So and also the integration of proper time gives the half length of the.
Yes.
So we have a path that goes to the infinity, which has finite length.
Yes.
Something like this.
Yes, because it's good that you are, because everything I find it puzzling. So don't believe too much to people that saying it's puzzling. Then we understood it, but again, it took him many years. The point is that what is misleading in these coordinates is that you think that this surface, the surface that describes the horizon, is a place. So you expect that it's a time-like surface. Okay. On the other hand, as it will become clear using other coordinates, it's a null surface. So it's not. That is why as I approach the horizon, the curve becomes more and more null. So this means that it has less and less length. So the length remains finite because it's like a curve in Minkowski, which becomes. Which touches the horizon, so it becomes more and more null. That's why it looks like it's an infinite length, but it's like saying that a light ray in Minkowski looks like an infinite, but it has zero length. Okay, so in this case, it would be a finite length.
Also, like the path from the eyes of the observer at infinity can never cross that horizon.
You said the eyes? No, the.
With respect to the infinite observer, in the eyes of it, it never crosses that. Can we ever do some coordinate transformation or anything to make it cross that line?
Yeah, we're going to do it. Yeah.
Is it okay?
I have a lot of material. It will take some time.
Does it make sense that we are able to do it? Because in this picture, it's not possible.
It's a good question. When we get to the explicit form, we can discuss. Let me go step by step. So I'm not to say that you already understood everything from this picture. But I have some material to convey. So let me first of all, before starting changing coordinates, let me make a very simple example that the world does, which is the following. It's nothing to do with black holes, it's just an exercise about a possible metric. So imagine that I come and I tell you, study this metric. Okay. So, in particular, given the form of the metric, T will be bound between 0 and plus infinity, while R is between, X is between minus infinity and plus infinity. So, if you're given this metric, most likely you start wondering about what happens at T equal to 0. Okay? Because you start saying, is it singularity? Now, okay. Let me tell you what is the answer. So somebody comes and tells you, please, can you use this coordinate? Okay? In this coordinates, the metric is this. Okay. So which is just a two-dimensional Minkowski space. What is the message of this? So there are two messages. One message is that you should not have been worried about what happens at t equal to 0 here, because t equal to 0 here corresponds to t tilde equal to infinity. So it's a place that will be reached only at infinite affine parameter. Okay? So the first message is that changing coordinates is not clear what is at finite distance and what is at the infinite distance. So doing this transformation, something which happens at infinite affine parameters is moved to a finite point. Okay? So this is the first message. More importantly, and related to this, you didn't, in this form, you do not understand what is the real issue. So the real issue is that it's not t equal to 0, but it's t equal to plus infinity, similar to what happens there. Why? Because you look at this and you say, okay, I don't care about t equal to plus infinity, it's plus infinity. No, the point is that t equal to, so a question that you should always ask to your metric is whether infinity, the infinity in the coordinates, so you remember, coordinates are nothing, so coordinates are just a mapping of the manifold on R. Now, there is no guarantee that your coordinates that extends to t equal to plus infinity, there is no guarantee that this point is not reached in a finite proper time. And this is exactly what happens here. You see, this is Minkowski space. Of course, I can go from positive to negative t tilde, nothing happens. But this corresponds to go to infinity in t, and then I have to go beyond these coordinates because I have to extend this to another chart. Okay? So I'm not saying anything very deep. I'm just telling you that imagine that I want to describe the manifold, which is the blackboard. Okay? Well, if I for some reason I may be interested in say, okay, I describe the manifold and I call this direction with a certain function, and this function goes to infinity here. Okay? Of course, if I give you the metric in this form, this line is called infinity. But this does not tell you that cannot be reached by a finite line. Okay, so it's just that at a certain point I can decide to call this wall infinity. Okay, we don't call it infinity, but I can go there in the finite time. It looks completely stupid, but this is exactly, we didn't think about this, but this is, it's exactly what happens here. So the fact that I go to t equal to plus infinity here looks very deep, but here on the other end looks completely stupid because it's okay. If you call it plus infinity, it's your business, then please me. Tell me how to go on, okay? So, bear this in mind, because I think it's important to understand that most of our problems with the intuition of general relativity has to do with the fact that we tend to give too much importance to the coordinates. So too much physical meaning. Again, if I, for some reason, I call this wall plus infinity, it looks that there are things going but it's exactly what we are doing using this coordinate, okay? So, okay. Okay? So I think that this at least should tell you that, okay, we didn't, now we go on, but this paradox is not completely a paradox. We just learned that, now we have to check, but at this point, the coordinate t, which is just a name, goes to infinity for all curves which are time-like. Okay. Well, even if it's like say that the coordinate goes to infinity for all observer going to the left. Okay. Now, the next step is the following. Well, first of all, I told you, but let's check. Is it true that I reach t equal to plus infinity in a finite proper time? Because I told you, but let's check. Right? I mean, it's exactly like here, checking that. I mean, here it's obvious after you do the change of coordinates. But if you want to remain in the first form, you can check that of course it takes a finite proper time to go to t equal to plus infinity, because it just corresponds to the origin of Minkowski space in the other form, so it's obvious. Here we do it explicitly. Well, for example, I do it for a geodesic. In a sense, okay, I could do it in general, but in particular, I do it for a geodesic, just to use a bit of what we did previously. So let me consider not a generic motion, but just a motion of a particle which is falling, just free falling in a black hole, radially. So they are just falling, okay? Without any angular momentum. Okay? So of course, so this is a particular state, but it already shows that even in this particular situation, nothing happens and there is a finite proper time. Yes. So, it's the usual thing that we did. So we take angular momentum equal to zero and we write the one-dimensional problem that we were discussing. In this case, there is no angular momentum, so the potential is just plus 1 half minus gm over r. And if you remember, this is equal to 1 half e squared. Okay? Okay, so it's completely obvious, but let me check. What I'm saying is the following. Now, forget about this picture. Let's go back to what we are doing. I consider a radial motion, zero angular momentum, okay? So this is a classical problem. Notice that, again, now we're talking about as a function of the proper time. So whatever we find is has to do with the proper time of the observer, not the coordinate time, okay? But it's pretty obvious because, you see, nothing happens at the horizon. So if I plot these objects, so this is zero at the Schwarzschild radius, and it's like this. Okay. So this is zero here. So this is an effective potential as a function of the radius. So this is 2gm. Okay. So now I repeat, what is the question? Well, this now is a one-dimensional mechanical problem. So forget about general relativity. It's just this. So the question is, so I have a particle moving in this potential. Okay. There is nothing deep. So the question is whether it will take a finite time in this system to cross this line. Well, nothing happens at this line. So in a sense, it's a mechanical problem. I have to decide the velocity and the energy. So this goes to a constant here. Okay, but independently of whether the energy is larger, so the point comes from plus infinity, or maybe it's like a stone which is bound, so it can go up to a certain distance and then it has to come back. But the point is that nothing happens here. There's no redshift or nothing. So it's just a one-dimensional problem, so I can calculate the tau it takes and it's fine. Okay. So is it clear? Sorry, but what I'm stressing is that this is not a singular point in this. And the trick is just that once everything is rewritten as a function of tau, I mean, it becomes a completely trivial one-dimensional mechanical problem, and this line is not singular in any sense. Okay? So it takes a finite tau to cross this line. Sorry, let me repeat, don't get confused. So once I write the problem in this way, everything is being taken into account. So we derive this equation using the conservation of quantities general relativity, defining the fact that the norm of the tangent vector is conserved. Okay? So once it is written like this, we can find a solution as a radius as a function of tau. It's not that I have to add some additional redshift factor, right? So this is tells you the evolution of the radius as a function of tau, and the fact that there is nothing singular going on at this point tells you that you, of course, you are going to cross it with a finite tau. Any question about this?
This potential will go asymptotic to the
It goes to minus infinity here.
But how this
happened? Why you are surprised about this? Because this happens also in Newtonian.
Yes, but look, like you gain infinite energy as you go into the. Is it the meaning that I just keep falling in a web? I'm gaining more and more energy, and I never also reach the origin. Or
I'm not sure what you're worried about. In a sense, he's telling you that. What is the problem? So because it's very similar to the Newtonian case, no? So as I go closer and closer to the r equal to zero, the potential becomes more and more negative. Of course, the kinetic energy. So let me put it this way. I don't see any surprise. What is telling you is that if I have a particle which is falling radially in a black hole, this is telling you that the radial velocity will increase because the potential is becoming more and more, so it will go faster and faster towards the singularity. Of course, there is a deeper question, is that what happens when you reach r equal to zero? This we're going to discuss, but for the time being, if you forget about r equal to zero, because I told you that it's a real singularity, so this is not something that we can solve.
What is strange here is that you think we're going faster and faster, but we're moving slower and slower.
Don't confuse this part of the blackboard with this part of the blackboard. So here we are talking about proper time.
Yes.
Okay. So what we learn is that as I go closer and closer to the source, to the center of the geometry, I move it's very important in this business to point to equation and not to our intuition. So by move here I mean dr in the tau.
Okay.
This becomes larger and larger. In this part of the blackboard we are using a completely different time, t, which as I'm trying to explain is a good time, is a good variable as when you are far from the black hole. Is a horrible variable when you are close to the Schwarzschild radius, okay? But it's a different variable, so, and there is no surprise, it's just saying that I can have a change of variable in which one becomes infinity while the other is finite, okay? So it's just adding like this. Okay. Okay, so this, putting these two things together, we get what we were discussing. So, because now I told you that this curve does this, cannot cross in these coordinates the Schwarzschild radius, but I told you that all this line has a finite tau, because here we see that the relation between r and tau is finite. So this means that the length of this curve is finite. Okay, so this means that if I send if I have to put these dots, okay, so I think there is an exercise. So you can calculate what these dots are, but I already know that since this total length corresponds to a finite proper time, there will be a finite number of emissions over, but distributed over an infinite time. So an observer at infinity will go on forever receiving more and more distant pulses forever. Okay. So from this point of view, again from this technical point of view, because you know, I think it's important always to define what you observe. So if an observer is at infinity, it will always receive pulses, and these pulses are saying, "I am outside the Schwarzschild radius. I am outside the Schwarzschild radius. I am outside," and so on forever. Okay. So. Always be careful because it's the same discussion that we had about the velocity. So when people say for an observer outside, this guy will never cross the horizon, well, it means what I was just saying, because of course we're talking about two different points. So there is a in words we can say, but what we mean is that if I send a signal, this signal will go on forever, and the guy will go on receiving signals from the region outside the spatial radius.
This is why this is very similar to a program where someone is moving with constant acceleration far from the other one.
Yeah, this is a very good analogy. Indeed, the next sector exercise will be about Rindler space. And you will see that many of these things happen also in Rindler, and also these subtleties about finite, you reach infinite coordinate in a finite time. So just to say that it's not so disturbing. It happens also in this game. So it's like having a constant acceleration. Okay, so before starting the weekend, I want to do at least one change of coordinates. So I want to choose the so-called tortoise coordinates. So notice that, as far as I know, there is no systematic way of finding nice coordinates. Okay. So we're going to discuss many coordinates. In different coordinates, something is obvious, something is not obvious, some coordinates have advantages, something like that. At the end, for Schwarzschild, there is a nice final form, well, nice at least to understand the properties related to the black hole. In a sense, of course, if you are very far away, it's better to keep this form. And this final metric was discovered, as I said, in the 60s, after many attempts. So I just to say that it's an art to find good coordinates, okay? But there's no systematic way of making. Okay, so I'm just taking this metric. Notice that from now on the angular variables are suppressed. So also notice that the radius of the spheres will always be given by this r. So this means that if at a certain point r will disappear. So that, so of course, if you want to complete the angular part of the metric, you have to write r squared as a function of the new variables, because r, I will not change the fact that the spheres have radius r. Okay. So to complete the metric, you have to write r squared as a function of the variables that you are using times the omega squared. But I will not write this part. Okay, sometimes it is useful to use what they are called the tortoise coordinates. So these are coordinates which achieve the following. So I want, it's nice to have a metric in which the light cone is always at 45 degrees, because it has the advantage that at least for the causality, at least so if you have a metric and the light cone is over 45 degrees, at least from the it looks a lot like Minkowski. Of course, maybe it's not flat space, but the advantage is that if you want to tell me whether this point is time-like, space-like, or null-separated, I just use the same intuition. So light cones remain at 45 degrees. So the idea of these coordinates is just to redefine the radial variable in such a way to make the cone remain open. Of course, in order to do that, you are forced to move these to infinity. Okay. So, but they are used also for, apart from understanding, they are very useful. So let me mention them. Well, how do you do that? Well, you want to keep these equal to one. Okay. So you want to use. Let me do the following. Let me calculate what is I integrate this equation. So delta t is equal to the integral in dr over 1 minus 2gm over r. Okay. So this what does it mean? Integrating this equation, I'm basically looking at what is the evolution of the variable t as a function of r as I move on the light cone. Okay. So this is how delta t changes as I move on the light cone bearing r. Okay, so I can do this integral. And this integral gives r plus 2gm log of r over 2gm minus 1. Okay? I mean, you bring this at the numerator, you blah blah blah, so you put it back at the mean doing the integral, so you get 1 and then you get a log. So again, this is the relation between, so I can start for example. So I do the integral now. So this is nothing new. So it tells you the relation between r and t in these coordinates. But now, if I call this object by definition r star, and instead of now you see, I was talking about making a mapping between one coordinate and another. This mapping is in the radial direction, not in time, but it has the same flavor. So now you see the horizon, which is at r equal to 2gm, this vanishing radius, corresponds to this going to zero, so the log go to minus infinity. This is as promised, because I was telling you that you keep this open. You keep this open because you see now in these coordinates there is a linear relation, well, by definition, there is a linear relation between delta t and r, because I chose this r in this way. But of course, I have to pay this price moving the horizon to infinity. So in these coordinates, light rays, they are t equal to plus or minus r star. Of course, there is a constant, because there is no dependence on time, so everything is up to a constant. Okay, there are the two light rays, one going towards the center of the geometry, so going towards the black hole, and the other one coming out. Okay. The metric, what is the metric in these coordinates? The metric, well, is not so surprising. It's given by this. Of course, you can do the change of coordinates, but I didn't do anything. First of all, let me mention. So here is r, it's not r star. So if you want to be very explicit, I write r as a function of r star. Why I'm doing this? Because I cannot invert this relation. Okay, so I cannot I cannot find r as a function of r star. I only have the inverse. Okay, but in principle, it's one-to-one, this relation, so for any r star, I can calculate the corresponding r, okay? I cannot be explicit. So, as I was mentioning, if you want to complete the geometry, you should write plus r squared as a function of r star, times the omega squared, okay? Because again, R, we chose, I mean, notice that different areas have different advantages. So this R, you remember, we chose it, we like it very much, because it is the radius of the sphere, so it has a geometrical meaning, okay? This R star does not have this geometrical meaning, so that if I want to know the radius of the sphere, I have to go back and calculate what is R, okay? But it has another advantage that you see the, let me erase this part. So why I know that this is the metric? Well, because if I look at the light cone, I remind you, correspond to look at dA squared equal to zero. So I look at null rays. So null rays do not care about what is in front of the metric, so they just correspond to this solution. So I know that the metric must be of this form, because I didn't do anything on the time variable. So what is in front of dt squared must be the same as before, okay? But I also know that by definition I chose this metric in such a way that the light cone is at 45 degrees. So I must have something which is proportional to Minkowski. So you can check, but this is what you get. So to conclude, I mean, it's not the end of the story, but I will continue on Monday. The light cone in this the icons in this geometry, they always stay at 45 degrees. Okay, so as a function of this variable t and r star, with the difference as now the horizon has moved, so this Schwarzschild radius moved to r star equal to minus infinity. Okay. So, what is the advantage of these coordinates? Well, first of all, it has the advantage that, well, for example, if you're interested in studying the behavior of massless field in this geometry, the fact that it's technically one says that this metric is conformally flat. Mean that apart from a factor in front, it is a flat space. So it's just Minkowski times a function of the coordinates. So it's you gain some intuition. For example, if you want to study the propagation of electromagnetic waves in this geometry, well, in this case, you know that photons will always travel at 45 degrees. But it did not solve too much our problems, because now we're even more confused, because before, we were going to t equal to plus infinity. Now we moved the horizon to minus infinity. Okay, so now it's not clear what's, but it will be a first step. Then on Monday we're going to change the coordinates in another way, and eventually, hopefully, we'll see some light. Okay. Should I write?